colleagues, let us begin our third and last lecture by Mr. Andris Piebalgs on this series of EU topical policies. This time the lecture will cover topic on European Union's multi-financial framework, EU budget aspects. The framework of the lecture is rather the same as it was in the first two lectures. We have 90 minutes of lecture, then a short break, and then we'll continue from there. As for your homeworks, thank you very much to them who did submit them. And also about the certificates, we will inform you electronically about where and when you will be receiving certificates for attending this course, as well as you'll be those who submit all the homeworks will be informed about receiving two extra ECTS points. And now I would like to give floor to Mr. Andris Piebalgs and the lecture.
I'm happy that some of you have survived to the two lectures, so and you are even have had the courage to come for the third. Well, it will be a bit different compared with the previous ones, because my time as budget commissioner was rather limited, and it was before European Parliament elections when some of the commissioners decides to run for the European Parliament. They are not allowed to exercise a duty for some time. So basically all pre-election campaign, they should take leave. Well, it's a good question, it's paid or not paid. I think it's not paid, so they're just having a leave, and some of the existing commissioners of the college has a second mandate during that period. And when President asked me, could I replace Commissioner Lewandowski, I thought, well, my multi-annual financial framework is being adopted, not big difficulties to be expected, and I agreed. Unfortunately, all my experiences with finances have been rather painful, and even this short time that I have spent was rather painful. Because already in the next week, I have a Foreign Affairs Council, and Cathy Ashton, that was at that time High Representative of Foreign Affairs, she's very angry looking at me, and after the meeting she comes, why have you done this to me? I said, I have done? I have done nothing. She said, look at this paper, and I have signed a paper basically saying that part of the expense that she would like to increase for the next year, well, I disapprove. I just signed the paper. And, well, she said, but you can, we are independent external action service, independent institution, why can't you send to the budgetary authorities? And my answer is, I can't, because by law, I need to consolidate. We somehow had after that very delicate relationship, because she regarded me as a colleague, and unfortunately, relationship was not perfect. Okay, that's the first. The second was a call from the European Court of Justice, from the president, exactly the same topic, why you cut the expense that we would anticipate for the next year. And the increases have been not huge. In both cases, we speak about, 20 million. For national budget, it would be a lot, but for these parts, it's not big. And extreme disapproval of the Commission action. And to make things worse, I also needed to take strategic decision, because when you prepare the next year budget, you really need to see how to balance the budget, because the demands are higher than actually you could provide the means. And from the service, there came proposals. Well, we have a chance to give to more or less headings, and you will see what means headings, to proportionately, with exception of cohesion, or we cut each heading proportionally. And the problem for me is, as a commissioner responsible for development, I would definitely would love to have as a first proposal that cohesion suffer. As a politician from the countries that mostly receive cohesion or structural funds, I have not this interest. So that you have a choice between rock and hard place. I took not advice of my service in this case, but I have had later very difficult relationship with my own service that they believe that I have taken wrong decision. So whatever you did in finance, my experience is, well, it's not very popular. You should have very strong character, and basically you should be called Mr. No. Whatever is asked, you say no, it's not possible to do, and that's it. Well, EU budget in a way is a better structure, and it is a bit of thanks of to historical development. Usually it seems that budget commissioner is extremely powerful. And I could quote British Commissioner Tugendhat, it was somewhere in the 70s, how he called his job boring and unimportant and small beer. Well, I don't know why he mentioned small beer, but it should be something British that's saying, well, it's completely waste. To be at that time as well, to make have less importance it was seen, it have been two commissioners. Roy Jenkins was president of the commission, and the same representative of the country, UK, was budget commissioner. So that means that the budget was always seen less glamorous, and it's true, because basically you work with parliament and council, and it is rather, I would say, not spectacular. But, and at the end of the day, money matters. Whatever policy you would like to propose, you have no chance achieve anything only by regulation. You need also financial means. And in 70s, 80s, there have been a lot of difficulties that partially have been solved, but partially still affects today's budget. There have been empty chair crisis 65, 66. Now, basically, it was disagreement between France and its partners of the financing of the CAP. But just to indicate where the problem at least was until 1970 is mostly related that, as any international organization at that time, communities have been financed directly by member states' contributions. And that is always extremely unpopular situation, because if you need to finance some outside, it's never easy decision to take, because I could give example from my time as I was responsible for education. Creation of Stockholm School of Economics was foreseen for three Baltic countries. So you get the students also from Lithuania and Estonia. So to try to cover the financing or to get at least some part financed by my colleagues from Estonia and Lithuania was impossible. Because not because I could not convince them, but it was very difficult for them to convince the parliament saying we need to finance education establishment in another country. So that definitely was not a good idea. And the Hague Summit 1969 introduced own resources, revenues that automatically accrue to the community. Which resources they have taken? First it is customs, because for customs border, definitely it's a good part of revenue. Then levies on sugar. I have not quite got by levies on sugar. It was definitely not a fight against obesity. It was some consideration why it was seen that it will be less resisted if you levy on sugar. It also mostly was imported, but that is another sort. Agricultural levies on some other imported products and a cut of VAT. So it's quite logical, but you will see later that this source of revenue is still not very much perceived as a good. If you have common markets, that value-added tax is actually the one that is, in my opinion, politically most correct to share. The difficulty is that you need to consolidate the same basis, because the value-added tax is differently taxed in different countries, and additionally, you need also to agree with the percentage how, what percentage part you will get to the financing of EU budget. So at least for the second, they have agreed 1%, and they also agreed on harmonized base. So own resources have been created. That difference between EU and country, it's mostly run not by income part, but expenses part. And that is quite interesting, because if I see Latvian budget, well, perhaps it's not the best way, is you know what level of tax GDP grows, you know how much tax you will get, and then you decide how much you can spend. EU works a bit differently. You decide how much you can spend, and then you try to adjust the resources. And in 70s and 80s, there have been four outstanding issues that really jeopardized the whole work. One was unpredictability of CAP expenditure. Common agricultural policy was actually created for that purpose, to help European farmers in the market situation. So if the price drops down, you need to compensate. Unfortunately, you can't predict the fluctuation, but it is compulsory to compensate. So you don't know how much money you will spend. So actually, you have a situation where you still, you have obligation, but you don't know if you have enough money. And that definitely made this own resource decision less important. Then it was UK accession. So UK story runs from the day one when UK sought actually to join. And that is explicable on the basis of what are the own resources that I mentioned. One reason is that UK imported more agricultural goods and everything else from the third part. So it's less from the common market. So as a result, what you get as a you are paying more in the budget of the EU. But you don't get enough also because common agricultural policy paid less for UK farmers because of different level of agricultural structure. So as a result, UK in a way thought that she's punished twice. They pay more in the budget, and at the same time, they get back less. So it was the issue that permanently jeopardized, particularly in the time when there was British president of the commission, Roy Jenkins, because its permanent irritation was there. Third issue was related to a bit of democracy. European Parliament get budgetary powers. European Parliament was never easy animal already at the beginning. Today it's even more challenging and difficult body because it has its own personality, but it's very difficult, predictable personality. And as soon as they get the powers, they wanted really to establish themselves. And fourth, it's nothing particularly new. EU, or countries of the EU at that time, have economic decline. So basically, the four factors made budgetary debates completely impossible. So people have fighted, screamed, and, well, no good working atmosphere and predictability, what the EU can do. The only good decision at that time, but it was did not help, was creation of the Court of Auditors. It was anticipated in the Brussels Treaty. Court of Auditors is one of the institutions that is extremely underestimated in the EU. It is a crucial institution because it basically gives, well, prepares Parliament's view to give discharge. And whenever Court of Audit writes something negative, even if by law you need to put, you are allowed as a commission or any other body, explanation why you don't believe that court is right, court's opinions plays enormous political weight. And creation of this Court of Audit immediately created a problem, because court published in 1979 a critical report on the European Commission, and Parliament immediately said Commission is making extravagant expenses. So that's 1979 was definitely not a good year for the Commission, because Margaret Thatcher came to power in the in the UK, and also European Parliament even rejected draft budget 1979. So communities have had very, very difficult a year. To sort the situation out was proposed by President Tone's rather radical proposal, and I will just quote him. "I cannot accept it as an article of faith that the current ceiling on budgetary resources is sacrosanct." Because European budget at that time was considered 1% of GNP, gross national product. What he says, basically, and it's not such a stupid idea, if we can't agree at this stage that some gets not enough and some others, let's increase overall expenses in some categories that are not related to common agricultural policy, and they will get more. So as a result, balance changes and everybody is happy. But he forgot one thing. It's still unpopular to give money to Brussels even in that time. So as a result, proposal, even well meant, and actually later followed, did not move. With Parliament, the crisis went even further. Today, it's difficult to even to imagine that at the end of the day, Parliament and Council, with Commission in between, needed to agree that some part of expenses where Parliament has a right to amend, another part is not for Parliament to amend. The last, I think, was it was 10 years ago when Parliament got right also amend agriculture. Agriculture was sacrosanct, you could not move to it, but it's another cut. And it was Fontainebleau summit in June 1984 where solution for UK came by French. Basically, they said two-thirds you get back. And it's where the Maggie Thatcher followed, I don't know if she was the first, Khrushchev was the first. Because Khrushchev was Soviet leader, you remember in UN, when he, I don't know what he demanded basically. He took a shoe off and put on table saying whatever he said. I don't exactly, Margaret Thatcher took just her handbag, "I want my money back." That is coming from Fontainebleau. And basically she established a system that more or less functions today. And even if it is not perfect, it kept until recently everybody more or less happy. What changed it? It was, I think, now a year ago, when Prime Minister Cameron said, "Well, Commission is demanding 2 billion from us. It's unacceptable." And he tried to politicize this agreement, because when you make these calculations, you have first need to change GNI, because gross national income changes during the year. Then you have made adjustment, and UK's economy went better than expected. That's why 2 billion. But rebate is also bigger. And rebate comes, this calculation, in a month. So he politicized the issue, and now, in a way, the issue is open. Even if it was nothing wrong was done, no political decisions are taken, and that demonstrates how difficult it is. But the solution for the current system basically is coming from Delors, 1988, where he came forward with multi-annual financial perspectives. That is the first that you have at least 5 years financial perspective. And overall raising of ceiling of community expenditure, and today it is 1.23% of GNI, and I don't expect that this figure 1.23% of GNI will change well in next 20 years, neither up, neither down. I think it is a cut in the stone. You would say, what is the logic behind it? I would say there is no logic. It just decided, and it's so difficult to change it later. Is it a lot? I would say no, but member countries would say it's enormous. But there is a lot. And also, Delors introduced the resource that brings now most of the own resources to the communities. It is a resource based on GNI or GDP, and that definitely made a lot of change. So we can now move on MFF. Multiannual financial framework is the basis of the European Union financially. The good news is that you need to discuss this very painful budgetary issue only once in 5 or 7 years. I think that is why politicians love it. You come once, you have very difficult time, but when you have done it, then it runs 4 years to come. So that gives good political, I would say, solution. Second, what is good as well, and why I like for community, it gives also very much predictability of the whole system. And in multi-annual financial framework, you also take in the package own resources decision. Own resources decision is basically, I think, generally creative, because it does not expire with the time. It expires only when the next decision is being taken. Because normally you have an own resource decision, and then you need to ratify in each member country, because money is something that you need national ratification. So you could say ratification procedure goes forever and community is blocked. No, you apply the previous system, and when new system comes in place, you make adjustment. Then is also, you would ask, well, why everybody is still happy to pay? Why we never heard that some country have not paid? Well, own resources decision makes a huge fines if you are late. So basically there is financial penalty so high that you have no interest to do it. But in principle, this MFF gives expenditure ceilings for expenditures that union could take. It is interinstitutional agreement between Commission, Parliament, and Council about implementation of it. It gives own resources decision where the money will come, and it gives a spending programs as well where you can spend money. There is a challenge on spending programs because you can't in debt union. Treaty on the functioning of the European Union on Title II financial provisions says that the budget should be balanced. So own resources always should be sufficient to provide financing for the programs. And that's additional weakness from the union point of view. Because from member country point of view, they would like to pay as little possible in the EU budget. How to pay as little as possible? Have as small programs as possible. So as a result, it is this balanced budget plays a bit against, I would say, stronger union, or at least union stronger supported financially. Because you try to cut payments, and as a result, you also need to provide less your own resources. And that makes a lot of perturbation. It is also that MFF runs for 5 years, so we have started from 1988, and it also says that there is a detailed process for adoption of the budget, and if budget is not adopted, each yearly budget, then you pay for particular credit line 1/12 of each month of the expenses. So if the budget annual is not adopted, you can pay, still get the financing. And when the parliament now struggles sometimes in the council, then some of the MEPs says, well, actually, it's better that budget is not adopted because we get even less than the previous year. But they forget that you are bounded by months, so there is no predictability and you can't start a new program. So anyhow, union is in vital need until beginning of fiscal year always to adopt the budget. And that's why procedure is so described, and we will come on more particular some issues. I think one of the issues that you need to take in account, and as I for me it was a big change, even if I have dealt in finance in my year, it is commitment appropriation and payment appropriation. And that's why sometimes union is extremely unpopular, I would say externally. Commitment appropriation actually is quite good. It's legal pledge to provide finance provided that certain conditions are fulfilled. So basically you say, we have a, you would implement a program, educational program for me. I am saying, well, this is the money that you will get. If you prepare a program, if you make a, well, teach students, and you will get this money. But I am not specifying exactly when it will be, when the conditions will be right. And with my working with third countries in development, it makes sometimes, I would say, perverse effect. We work with so-called budgetary support. Budgetary support means that if you follow good governance and follow, achieve some criteria, you will be paid. And we write in agreement, and it's commitment appropriation. But unfortunately, there are human rights violations. And as a result, you are unable to make payment. And our partners are extremely cross because they believe that you have not fulfilled your obligation. So this commitment appropriation is a good way to plan, but it's not guaranteed that money will be paid. And that sometimes creates a lot of challenges. But that's, I think, is not a bad idea because it will be covered in principle. Payment appropriation is actually cash, and the bank transfers to the beneficiaries. Then another issue is annual ceiling, expressed in GNI. Why is they use GNI? I can't quite say, because in a way it's correct, because it's total domestic and foreign output claimed by residents of the country. So basically it's national wealth, because there could be in GDP definition. If somebody is exporting wealth, so profits out, basically it doesn't stay with the country. So it's much more correct from the wealth point of view is to take GNI. GNI as a measure of, well, EU spending. And the magical figure, as I told, said it could never be higher appropriations than 1.23%. In reality, it's by far lower because member countries try to get as less as possible and parliament tries to get as high as possible. So what you end up is actually with a problem. Because when the compromise is being get between the parliament and council, you see the clash of two cultures in a way. Because from member countries, what matters is cash today or tomorrow. So they are very hard on payment appropriation. And commitments, okay, there will be new government, there will be elections, somebody will deal with. And so you get huge gap or growing gap between commitment appropriation and payment appropriations. And when I was in commission, we start to get a new situation. Because normally, especially in development, the payments went at the end of the year. So basically you try to spend the money for the year. You have had a difficulty, and I have had a special administrative system that working that we are fulfilling what is being promised to members countries that we will spend. Because they are unhappy if we don't spend, because the money is being idle, and that is not what member countries would like. But in recent times, we actually stop spending at the end of the year because we have spent all the cash and we still have claims coming in. And that gives for the whole commission actually headache, because you need to balance between different parts really to get a balance on this. And it's not really so easy. But This is rather crucial to well understand that commitment and appropriation actually is real promise. It's not fake promise. It's really promise. But you need to deliver to get the money, and commission should have the money to pay exactly when you deliver. Because there could be a situation that commission is unable to deliver, and then commission would pay a late payment. That's how it is. So it's not good what we have created with this gap that it is. So the main advantages of MFF: predictability, planning security, budgetary discipline, because you know what is, and also there is some degree of flexibility in this multi-annual framework, financial framework. So it's good mechanism, and I would wish sometimes that member countries could have something like this, because it's enormous advantages. And again, coming from development perspectives, when European Commission gives a pledge to support, it's always covered by money, because we can't make political pledge just because of political consideration. It should be always covered by finance. When the country X makes a pledge, huge pledge, it's always subject to budgetary la-la-la, or if the money there will be. So I think that is enormous, enormous advantage of it. But it is something that I think it's good that could be used more broadly in the world. How to come to this MFF? Basically, you need agreement between commissions that makes a proposal, council, and parliament. And from my experience, I have gone through two MFF proposals. And there is something that I believe at some stage need to be changed. Because commission pace is 5 years, and multi-annual framework is 7 years. And what you get, if you, we will see from Juncker's commission, if it's follow Prodi's commission. Because as a commission, you have always temptation to make a generous proposal for Europe, for European citizens. But you need to come with a proposal if you are not, if you are actually close when it to be discussed, that has a chance to be adopted, because otherwise you have lost. So what happens with Prodi commissions? They made fantastic proposal because they needed not to negotiate. So Barroso came in, and the next commission needed to negotiate. So what happened? We needed to change the proposal, and we got extremely unpopular, because the proposal of Prodi was such a nice, and proposal from Barroso commission, such a pain in the neck. So as a result, you have this disbalance. But and now the situation is similar with Juncker's commission. They came in when actually budget is adopted. They need to propose the first for the next framework, but they will not negotiate it. So they could go realistic or ambitious. And unfortunately, ambitious and realistic in finance is never quite the same. It's two different things, and I believe that is one of the challenges that we have, because nowadays everybody looks on the 7 years. There is some particularity always discussed in the financial framework discussions. When you try to negotiate something, and negotiations are going rather difficult, you say, well, by first opportunity we will change this. And the opportunity always is there. It's so-called midterm review. Midterm review, you can postpone all the demands that you can't actually pacify at that moment, saying, after 3 years, we will come back, we will change, you will get what you ask. It is rather good promise, I think, done in honest spirit, but it's very difficult to keep. Because when you come in 3.5 years onto midterm review, you still have political challenge. And member countries are not so happy to have a big clash in the midterm review. I have lived through two midterm reviews. None of them brought big changes. Minor adjustment to spending programs, but they have been not big revolution. But now we could see, because it's already 2017, so we will see how member states react. So you can change, provided that all the institutions agreed during the midterm. So it is a it's not cut in the stone. You can once during the period really to move on. The procedure is rather simple. Commission makes a proposal and council adopts by unanimity and parliament gives its consent. It sounds rather simple, but it's in reality by far more complicated. Yes, college makes proposal. That so far is good. But when commission have made proposal, it's not any more important player in MFA. That's very strange that it is not so much well regarded, because then you have member countries, and it's at this stage, it's European Council that tries to deal with this. It's not on the normal ministers level. It goes to heads of state, and sometimes after MFF are adopted, you always think, was all of them in the same room? Because how they try to explain what they got out of it, it is very, very different story. So it is extremely politicized discussion, usually late at the night, and usually a lot dominated by bigger member countries than by smaller ones. Because smaller ones usually need to have very much focused attention. And just to give Latvia's example, and I believe we have done very well in the last negotiations, we have two focus. Number one, I would say the most critical is direct payments for the farmers. Politically, it was extremely, I would say, expected that they would be breakthrough. And second, that perhaps is more financially important, increase potential what we can get from structural funds. You can't get more. For bigger countries, it's more gains. But basically, all countries are trying to get the balance so that you pay less, get out more. What is also claimed, but I have not really much proofs, that it changed with German Chancellor Schröder. Under then, Germans have been rather generous in this discussion. When more money was needed, actually Germany did not cry to provide the finance. With Schröder, was German interest came as any others. And if we have seen how the budgetary rebate has evolved, we have now a rebate mechanism for UK, we have some type of arrangements for Germany, we have arrangement for Netherlands, we have for Sweden, for Austria. So you got this process that each country is trying really to focus on figure language and less actually what you get from the measures implemented. And that argument is continuing very much. What, how to measure what you get out of the EU budget. Because it can't be that you just put stream in and you measure what is coming out. Because it's created for policies. And definitely some countries from the internal market development benefit more than the others. But how to measure it? So it will stay very, very much politicized. And again, I don't expect, I think it will be 2020 when they will set the leaders, that it will change the character of debate. It gets only more complex because it's 28 and it's unanimity. Later on, Council, when there is an agreement between heads of state, still continues to fight about details because not all details have been clear enough, but you get it. The challenge now is very much from European Parliament. As I told, European Parliament sees EU budget from completely different perspective compared with member countries. They see it as a budget not of pain, but of opportunities. So they really try to increase the spending. And there you get a complete mismatch. And agreement on this is getting more and more difficult to make. So I don't exclude that 2020 there will be extremely difficult relationship between the parliament and council. Because the tendencies, if I see in both ways, is going in completely opposite direction, and at the end of the day, you need to find the common language. And Parliament is getting more and more aware that with commitments, you are not too much help. You really need also payment appropriations and payment credits. But we are lucky, we are over it, and as I told, midterm review, we will see, but it will not be something that we should be extremely worried. What does we have in the MFF? We have a ceilings, maximum amount for each spending area, both in commitment appropriations and payment appropriation, and also headings. Headings are basically broad categories of expenditure. We will come back to this issue and to see it. The most now popular is smart and inclusive growth. Why it gets such a popularity? For two reasons, basically. One, B is extremely interesting to member countries that are more poor. It's a main area of where we get money out. For the UK and more developed or more rich countries, they look here because that gives money to research and they put profit more. As I see in general, this this part of the heading usually gets more and more, and it will be more and more developed also in the future. Sustainable growth is more broader than actually is usually seen. It's one part is agricultural payments, that is support of common agricultural policy, rural development, and also some programs related to environment. But if I would say correctly, it is how to spell it. This is agriculture, and this is, well, I would say, industrial part, if I may. It's not completely correct about this, but these two headings get the lion's share. At some stage, I think it was Chirac-Schroeder discussion, there was agreement that it will be 50-50, but with the time, agriculture spending is coming down, and in a way, improves UK budgetary situation, and this part is going up. But it's still rather challenging, really, to get it. Then is a new growing heading, security and citizenship. I was quite astonished that, I don't know if it's correct information, that now in Commission's proposals it seems that for each person that will be well accepted in the EU on solidarity based on migration, the Commission or from EU money will provide 6,000 euros. The money could come only from the security and citizenship. It's a rather small part of heading, and I don't know if it is really enough to cover or now 40,000 times 6, you can calculate, which is an enormous amount of money, and it's definitely will increase with the time, because you can't make solidarity in migration and asylum if you have not very serious money. Global Europe, it is basically external relations, and I will come to more detailed explanations. Administration is, who runs the whole system, and compensation is rather small amount, around 27 million a year for some type of activities. So as I told, each has expenditure heading, each heading, and overall heading as well. As here I tried really to explain what is behind of each heading, because when you read the heading, I assume that most people who could not guess what is below it, just to get better understanding. So under competitiveness for growth and employment, it is research. It is a main beneficiary. It's trans-European networks, both for energy and transport, and competitiveness innovations programs. So this is a basically forward-looking part. Cohesion for growth and employment, it is cohesion between regions inside the country and member states, cross-border cooperation, and also job opportunities, social funds. So it is really trying to get more coherence inside the country, but also in the whole EU. For preservation and management of natural resources, it sounds very extremely complex, but in reality, it's agriculture, rural development, and environment programs. That's what it is. Freedom, security, and justice, migration, border management, fight against the crime, it's a small amount, relatively, judicial cooperation. Citizenship, well, that's even more confused. It's mobility, health, consumer protection, culture. It's rather small programs, but it is under this. EU is a global player. It is quite a lot of money here. It's enlargement, neighborhood policy, fight against poverty, humanitarian aid. Administration is here I would like to mention that EU as a global player does not take into account the European EDF, European Development Fund. Because for the countries of ACP group, Africa, Caribbean, Pacific, there is a fund that is outside the budget. And it's managed by the Commission. It's financed by member countries on the basis of GNI key that is very close how they finance the budget, but it's not sufficiently, I would say, scrutinized by European Parliament. They may have a scrutiny, but not the same type of level that is used towards a budget. And that's very clear that these 7 years are the last for European Development Fund. Parliament accepted, I think, with a lot of sympathies for this type of measures that EDF still exists because of fight against poverty. Because it was clear if you integrate it in the budget, ceiling will not go up. It will stay more or less the same. And Parliament had two difficult choices: more scrutiny from one side or more support for the poorer people in the world. And Parliament decided, well, we can wait a bit with big scrutiny. And it definitely asks from the Commission all the information and gets, but it's not completely under democratic scrutiny of European Parliament, and it will change. So that will be additionally, I don't know how it will come into this, because this relationship is based on the Cotonou Agreement, but there will be some changes in this part. This is how I mentioned all the commitment approach, payment appropriation. About payment appropriation, there is a, when you make a commitment, you also need to have a payment in some limited time, otherwise you lose the money. And there's N+1, N+2, and N+3 rules. So it's different part of expenditure you can keep for some time. If you don't deliver, you lost the money. And that you know for structural funds who works in member countries, it's extremely, well, painful if you have money anticipated or committed and you don't get it. So it is really, I would say, disaster. On MFF revenues, I already spoke. Traditional own resources, VAT own resources, GNI own resources. Actually, I should have mentioned also some other revenues here. You put also on net asset surplus from previous year. That is interesting because it is allowed by treaty. If you have not spent the money, you can bring forward for the next year. In national politics, in national finance, you are not allowed to do this. You can, you need to spend or you lose. If you have not spent, you can't lose. In EU, that's a positive thing. You can surplus next, bring to next year only for administration. And then there is other revenue. One is taxes from EU remuneration. So EU employees pay taxes to the union. So it comes back to the budget. But there is also fines. Fines that imposed on Microsoft, Google, or potentially it could also be imposed on the Gazprom. It takes a bit of time, it's a bit unpredictable source, but it's a huge source. It's in billions, and it also goes to EU budget, but it's difficult to budget because there's a legal procedure that takes 4-5 years, you impose a fine, and still you can't really to put in the budget, you can, it's paid, so you put it on the onto account, but you can't use it until all the legal procedure has not changed. So that's why I did not mention it is a big source, but actually it is a good source when you need to change the budget. The question that usually arises, how much citizens pay to it? Well, directly, in a way, yeah, you no one pays directly, but indirectly through VAT, key, yes, a bit each of us are paying. But still in general, if I see the, all the sources, that's basically 64 euro cent per day, but it's average. So Latvians are paying less, and I assume Germans are paying more. So, but that is a figure, you get the understanding how much proportionally is for the EU budget. It's not small amount, I would say. It's quite, on during the year, if you have 360 days, you can calculate that well, it's nearly would be 200 euros a year, so it's not small. But anyhow, you raise the taxes, and it's from overall tax systems that goes, so it is a figure that is not tragic. And here is, I think, one of the main issues that why we are now really reconsidering its own system. What we have, basically, it is GNI, own resource, that finance lion's share of the EU budget. And this is, well, how to say, it's good and not good. What is the main challenges with current own resource system? Basically, there are, I would say, two main challenges. One is that it's extremely complex because you have a rebate, you have different rebates on different sources, because rebates could be not only on GNI, it could be on traditional resources, it could be also VAT resource. So there is a rather untransparent system, and I mentioned this experience with David Cameron, that somehow society is completely misled because of complexity of the system. But there is another challenge. Even if GNI resource is called own resource system, it is still a bit of a challenge, because own resource system goes directly from Latvian Treasury to Brussels, well, to, in a way, through account system, but it goes directly there. And when you discuss the budget, then, as I told, each country has one goal, to pay as less possible to the EU. To get more, yes, but to pay less. And through GNI resource, it's the most difficult domestic political debate you have. I would say from VAT resource, in my opinion, the debate is more healthy, because you say, well, we are in the same market, we pay small part of the tax, and fine, why not? But GNI resource is already collected by member countries and later used. So there is a special discussion how to improve the own resource system. During the debate when we had in college, we basically proposed the financial transaction tax. That is a new tax that could provide own resource. There have been some discussion on VAT, but majority rejected this. So it is a question, should we stay on the GNI base and perhaps completely then what is the point to keep VAT? It just complicates the whole system. Or to find another tax that will provide part of our resources. There is still time to discuss. My assumption that no one really will try to fundamentally change the system. Because when you touch the system, you also touch the system of rebate. And Commission made a proposal to, for the financial perspectives, to change the rebate system to make it more transparent. And it was criticized both from Parliament and also from the Council. Not because it was a bad proposal, but because it changed the current balance. As soon you touch on something that is achieved in political negotiations, and not very logical, it's still political balance. And when you change, it is something that immediately creates a lot of challenges. How the EU funds are managed? Well, mostly it is through the member states and Commission together. So it's 78%, it is structural funds, definitely, but it's also common agricultural policy. That's why the figure is so huge, because it goes with the member countries and it will stay with this. The challenge there is accountability. Commission gets all the time criticized that it's not enough to supervise the funds by court of audit. At the same time, errors are usually made in member countries. How Commission could influence the member countries to make better accountability is a challenge. Also, fraud for structural funds on agriculture happens in member countries. And that means that we need really to somehow improve the cooperation in this particular branch. This 15% are managed by Commission in reality directly or by Commission itself, or through executive agencies. For a lot of programs, like for education, there is executive agencies, and they implement in the name of the Commission. They're fully accountable to the Commission, and at the end of the day, Commission goes for discards. And 7% is going through international agencies. It is going through the United Nations, World Bank, also Europe Investment Bank, European Bank of Reconstruction and Development. So it is rather complex structures that Commission need to get a discharge, but it provides that you need also some type of rules that you impose on your partners. So in this case, member countries, and if I see the current structural funds regulation or regulation also for common agricultural policy, I think now first time is there a request for preconditions to be fulfilled until the money is being transferred. For the international agencies, they need to provide exactly the same accountability as EU agencies. And that sometimes is rather demanding, because UN or World Bank sometimes complain that from the EU, the scrutiny is higher than from EU member states. But that's how its rules are, and you can't avoid it. It is rather challenging, but I don't see any other way how to deal with this. Now for 2014-2020, the budget, we will come to concrete figures. What we have is project, some particularities, project bonds initiative to stimulate key investments in infrastructure, to establish debt capital markets as an additional source of financing. And particularly now, I think it's interesting, so-called Juncker initiative, where you basically try to use EU money to raise money from the private investors to get more impact in the real economy. So you have grant resource, but you just don't spend grant resource on, well, relatively small problem. You try to accumulate private provided guarantees or some other type of financial instruments. What is interesting that even with this, you can't go in situation where you make a debt. So EU is not allowed, and I don't see that it will be. So you can't borrow the money, but it is really trying to make leverage for the final beneficiary who will pay the costs at the end of the day. I mentioned high level working already on own resources. So you change, really try to improve the system. I am a bit pessimistic that they will manage which comes the proposal the member countries will adopt. But there is another issue that perhaps will allow them. UK will start now to discuss, well, changes in EU. And one of the issues they will definitely come, it will be rebates issue. So perhaps that will allow really to restructure our own resources. So the pressure coming from the, I would say, intellectual argument, but also from political argument. And that could lead also to some real decisions. I mentioned review said 2017 when it should happen, but you start audit 2016. There is new spending programs. We will come to in detail to them. then it's more flexibility. So basically you are allowed to move inside the heading, but also between heading, provided some conditions are made. And that I think is rather good. And there is some special initiatives like youth employment initiatives that tries to address or help to address youth unemployment. Where the money goes, I think that is a good slide because it demonstrates clearly that it is heading 1A that is now. 1A, it is research, tents, and growth and well related. It's 13% of overall budget, but together with economic and social cohesion, territorial cohesion, it gives now 47% of EU budget. So 47% of budget basically goes to strengthen EU competitiveness and support labor-related initiatives. It's a huge shift because in early years, I would just mention that was the balance was 80% for agriculture and 5.8% for this type of measure. It is 1973, 1986, it was 64% for agriculture and 16% for more, I would say, competitiveness. So it's an enormous shift and the tendency is growing. Also under agriculture budget, it is market-related expenditure and direct payments is still considered, one-third, it's 29%. But what is growing is rural development. It is 9% of our budget, so it gives 38. And if I calculate also fisheries, it gives so roughly 40%. But the tendency is this part coming down, this part growing. So I think it's also long-term tendencies that will stay. Global Europe is 6%. It always will stay complain. Unfortunately, I don't expect that it will grow substantially because it is something that member countries agree in principle, but not exactly for money. It's a bit pity because to achieve the substantial results in fighting migration, it's less you can achieve under security of citizenship. But I spent money to fight the illegal migration, but actually with global support for fighting poverty and actually trying to eliminate the root causes. But I assume this part will grow, this would stay stable. And administration is going around 6%. Compensation has no real, because it's so small, it doesn't come into budget at all. So that's in nutshell the whole EU budget. So it is competitiveness, rural development, and slight bits, some other things. So it's basically two big issues that tries to address. If I see from the budget, it's a huge. It's 959,988,000. So it's basically trillions of Europe in the financial perspective. So it's a lot of money. If I see from the GNI, it's not big money. If I see from the figure, it's a lot of money. But when it's applied each year, it's definitely for 7 years, so it's less. So it is serious money, but perhaps could be more. Particularly, I would like to address one, to come back to explain what is under each heading. I will take, for example, Global Europe heading. Because Global Europe seems external relations. Actually, it's not only external relations. It's by far more under this. So what we have is, I will read all the instruments that we have for this 6% or budget. There is instrument for stability. It is money that you can use to support peace and security measures in critical situations. So money that you can deploy rapidly. There is also instrument for nuclear safety cooperation. that you can use for providing support like cleaning up after Chernobyl. There is instrument, European instrument for democracy and human rights. With this instrument you support elections, you support human rights processes. There is instrument called development cooperation instrument, basically main instrument to fight poverty, and last time we have seen that it's also subordinated to some others. There is humanitarian aid, there is common foreign and security policy for CFSP operations, there is called partnership instrument. It is an instrument created for the countries we don't do any development cooperation. It's for China, India, Brazil, so it grows global as an instrument. There is European neighborhood instrument that provides support for example, the countries that we have had less than 1 week ago in Riga. It is Eastern Partnership or partner countries around Mediterranean. There is instrument for pre-accession assistance, like Turkey, like Balkan countries. There is civil protection European Emergency Response Center. There is macro financial assistance. As you know, there was signed 1.8 billion support for Ukraine. It's coming from this budget. And there is also European voluntary humanitarian aid and corps. So it's basically enormous amount of instruments. So each of these paragraphs are divided in a lot of small instruments, and each of them should be implemented according to its rules of each of these small relatively program, because the program for nuclear safety cooperation is very small relatively, but still you have it. So it's not that you have one big money and you can use it. In recent times there have been some development in being to be more fast to respond in foreign policy. It is related to the need to act in situations like in Mali or Central African Republic. It's so-called EU trust funds. Basically, EU trust fund means that you put money under management of some board that is capable to deploy money very rapidly. But precondition is that there is also some EU member countries that put their money into it. For me, it is good idea. In Central African Republic, it's running. It's, I think, French, German, and the Commission is making it. And that gives a bit different dimension of the rapid, how fast we can react to the situation in the world. So it is some change. But main instruments there are, and you will be a bit surprised, the biggest is development cooperation instrument, so it works for support all countries with exception of ACP countries. It's 1.7 billion a year. Second biggest is instrument for pre-accession assistance in 1.4 billion, and explanation is Turkey is candidate country. So Turkey gets a lot of support from the EU. It's close to billion, because it has candidate country status. And Iceland also was at some status entitled, not now. And neighborhood instrument is more or less on the same level, 1.4 billion. Could we change these figures? Well, it's not so easy, because it is an agreement, and each country has its own priorities, so it is some balance. I would say it's not so logical to give so much money in pre-accession countries. But, well, it's decided, and that's how it is. The policy is that for me, but it is clearly for me being from Baltic country, is most important, it is structural funds. If I compare amounts that from structural funds Latvia or structural investment funds are getting, it's as if it is a European Structural Investment Funds. So it is a main driver of creating a welfare in my country, in my opinion. And the challenge is how to keep other countries to support the policy. And Commission made a decision that is rather illogical, you would say. Because we decided to have all EU like in three regions. You have main financing goes to the less developed, so GDP per head less than 75% of EU average. You have so-called transition regions that has moved out of 75, and explanation is if somebody comes out of the poverty, he always feels that he is, how to say, punished being successful. I disagree with this philosophy, but that's how it used. If you get some subsidy, you would, and you are independent, it takes a lot of personal courage to say, I don't need this subsidy anymore. Well, you can say it, but still will be happy to get it. And that's why it was this so-called transition. But also there is money for more developed regions. Why it was necessary? Because here GDP per head is more than 90% of EU average. And it was no other way how to keep the policy alive. So EU, all EU countries would like to get money back from ESIF. So there have been some evolutions that in my opinion is to be not healthy, but to keep the policy alive, it needs to be continued. I believe that this policy is something that really we need to focus also on the future, because overall funding for the policy is 351 billion euro. With national contribution, because it's co-financing and private, it would be going to 450. It's addressing the main grievances of, I think, of economic development of the countries. It consists of the basically five funds. So one is Regional Economic and Social Cohesion Fund, ERDF. Then is European Social Fund, Employment and Inclusion. Then is Cohesion Fund for member states with a GDP less than 90%. So it's not under this, but it is additionally. And then is our Fund for Rural Development and Maritime and Fisheries Fund. Overall investment level for a country like Latvia, it will be roughly 5.5 billion euro for 7 years. If I just to give the comparison, 2014, we have had foreign direct investments around 120 million euro. It's promised, actually. It's not necessary that it will all will come to realization. And that's completely different magnitude. And last year was a very good year. So I believe that this policy is really crucial, particularly for the countries and regions that are or in periphery of the European Union or to the places where for whatever reason is less economic activity. Otherwise we will get concentration only in some countries or in some regions here. What Commission has done also, in my opinion, quite positive this year, they gave 11 priorities where you can spend money. It's research, ICT, SMEs, low carbon economy, climate change, adaptation, mitigation, environment, transport, employment, inclusion, education, and public administration. And there is nowadays very strong focus on results. So I believe that it is one of the policies that has proven most, and especially in Baltic country case, but if I take also Poland changed definitely with a lot of good governance, but it also changed a lot because of structural funds. And I believe that is a policy that needs modifications, but it is the most crucial policy for it. And there is also a small part coming for so-called EU Solidarity Fund. It's 500 million euro. So it's maximum amount coming for the countries that suffer from the flooding or other type of natural disasters. So I believe that is one of the policies that we need to focus. Here is something that is just, we already talked. It is how the change, where the change is going compared with MFF 2007-2013. And 2014-2020. So for competitiveness, it's up. For cohesion, for the reasons I mentioned, it's less getting popular. It's slightly down, but still serious. For sustainable development, because of agriculture, it's slightly down. Security and citizenship, slightly up. global Europe more or less the same, and administration more or less the same. So the tendency, I believe, in after 2020, this will go up. I very much hope that this will at least stay stable, and here slightly down, and security will grow. I think these two headings basically will be unchanged. So the tendency is rather clear where MFF are going. Here we have a mostly where the spendings are, as I mentioned, smart and inclusive growth, 451, and this comes from these type of programs. Sustainable growth, natural resources is 373, and you see the other parts are far less. Where we have seen the development, I would say, on micro level, on the changes on particular programs. Connecting Europe facility is the one that changed a lot. And this is, I'm very happy, because it is definitely making infrastructure not only in transport links, but also for energy links. I think you have, if you followed Eastern Partnership Summit, you heard about the gas infrastructure where four Central Eastern European countries have agreed. It will be also partially co-financed run by this facility. So it is one of the issues that you try to capitalize on interconnections that increase the use of existing infrastructure or existing investments. I would just give an example. In Latvian case, we have built, don't ask me exactly why we decided to increase our capacity for gas, because there have been perception that for demand for electricity will grow. Well, it did not happen. It did not happen, but infrastructure is there. New, brand new infrastructure, again, it's based on gas, perhaps not the most. But there will be no use of this infrastructure inside Latvia. We don't see that the tendency of consumption is growing. But if I see EU market as a whole, it's well interconnected. Well, it could be interesting, because you should not create a new capacities in some countries where coal will be going out, and then you can just have all the infrastructure built. So I would say that gives enormous potential for the investments already made, because then could use them more targeted and use the synergies of it. Another program that I would be very unpopular, but I think we spend too much. It's Erasmus for All, it's mobility. Well, it is a lot of people who use the program are extremely proud about it. And I am saying, well, it was different times. It was difficult to travel between the countries to find the universities. Today, please do it. But it's very unpopular view, and it is seen as a flagship program. I don't believe that anybody will ever cut it, and it will be just increased. So, and there is good sides in a way, because it's not only mobility, but cooperation between the universities. And that's, for example, I see the chance for Latvian university. Latvian University has a real challenge. It is a rather small market it is placed. So to improve, you really need more competition. To make more competition, you need to work together with others. But it costs money. So the Erasmus money could definitely increase competitiveness of Latvian University in the global environment. So I think it is also quite important. Horizon 2020, it is a science program. It is quite serious growth, not exactly what Commission has proposed. We proposed more. And this is, I think, debate on Horizon 2020 on our research will continue. Because the difference with, I would say, US, Horizon 2020 basically more support, in my opinion, research networks. Networking between researchers. But it doesn't mean necessarily, or at least it's not proven, that it increased competitiveness. If I see US, it's a lot of money, very targeted investment for particular area. I would mention just one example from the one of the elections we used, batteries. For battery development, definitely will change a lot. To use in renewable sources of energy, you need to store energy. And you need batteries. whatever you and rather big size, not only for cars, but basic to store quite serious. It's very clear that breakthrough is still not there, because it's still costly, and you have not made the technologies that could be cost efficient. Obama said, well, there will be $20 billion in this research. In EU, you will never have this, never ever, because it's not anticipated like this. It's really anticipated to create a researcher network and expect that that provides a value. And I would say there is some logic behind, but if competitiveness will go down, there will be the challenge. Another is how to get private financing more in it. So I believe the research program will definitely grow in the future, but modification, how it's function, how it provides the best result, still debate is of us. From other programs, I would mention where I believe will be growth, it's European Neighborhood Instrument. Seeing what we have in Eastern Partnership, but also seeing what we happen particularly in Mediterranean, it's very clear that current amount of money is not sufficient. I don't believe that member states will cut other headings, but I am afraid the development cooperation instrument could suffer. Because if you have problem at your doorstep, it's very difficult to justify that you make good work in Bangladesh or Nepal. It's pity, but I assume that how the development will develop. Compared from 2030, the increase was not huge, and I could explain this also because we still have not got at that time eastern part of Ukraine. We have not got Ukrainian conflict, so we have a really completely new now geopolitical situation. ISIS problem was not also there, so this is I think where the money will come, not in short term but in the medium. I would like to end the whole story on the first part of the presentation on administrative expenses. Well, this is a story that always scores high in media. And the question is, do we pay too much for administration? Because it is $61 billion for 7 years. And the answer is, well, how to look upon it. If you would like that money that you collect from your citizen by taxes should be used according to the rules, wise and in good quality, you can't avoid paying the administration. It's natural. So there is no way how you can go around it. Otherwise, you lose more money than you gain. And expectations is that that it is staff will go down by 5%, and it will stay more stable. You would say, why it can't be only stable if it is actually you are cut by 5%? The reason is that people live longer. Also, retired commission officials or EU officials live longer. So as a result, you increase the pension costs, increases, and healthcare costs. It's a general problem, but at least what member countries have accepted that there is a cap and you need slightly to decrease. So what you get, actually, and it's a bit of a challenge and we need to discuss this, you get more money coming to the EU. So you have more responsibility to manage it in good way, and you have less staff. And there could be at some stage critical juncture, or you change the rules, how you use money, or you need more staff. So the story is not over, because if you have people managing tens of millions of euro, you need to have good quality of them. And that, I think, will be always discussion how to balance these two tendencies. Because today, I would say, all the commission is understaffed. If you see how many millions they need to manage and requirements that are put on the commission staff to implement it. So I believe it's really challenging issue. It's not very popular issue, but I believe in each and every country there should be a lot of respect for civil servants, because these are the people that really try to implement the policies of this country. The same with the EU. Yes, it is a job that perhaps are not very popular, but it is a job that you can't expect to done by unqualified people. And normally they are not, the salaries are not competitive with the private sector, but what is from other side, you have a rather stable environment. Because what I always enjoyed with my colleagues in the commission is that people are confident that they will not lose their job. And I think that's something that is good, and they more or less are clear what will be their pension and how is their health care covered. In a lot of private sector, perhaps the money gets you higher, but at the end of the day, you lose because of unpredictability of your future careers. So I would just give example from the energy sector. With high oil prices, it was excellent place to work. Now oil prices down, a lot of people get redundant. So it is always choice of personal career. But my point is, the main point, if you have public policies, you need to have administration to implement it. And it costs as much as it should cost. And 6% of cost for administration is not high cost to pay. So that's, I would like to really to emphasize that these are extremely important issue to be dealt with. So I think we can make a break and then we will continue. At the end, if I will be faster than the time I need to entertain you, we can talk about all other issues of the EU, because as I told, budget issue is not the most sexiest issues from the EU, but it is extremely interesting if you try to get into detail. So if somebody has a lot of interest in figures, and I think it's fantastic area, because it's not boring, but you need to be particular mindset. So I think it is a very, very interesting area, and with a lot of developments are still in front of it. It's not very spectacular, but still it's good area to continue to be focused on. So let's make a break. Now it is 7:45 until 8:00.